أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعماءه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون الذي لا يدركه بعد الهمم ولا يناله غوص الفطن الذي ليس لصفته حد محدود ولا نعت موجود ولا وقت معدود ولا أجل ممدود فطر الخلائق بقدرته ونشر الرياح برحمته ووتد بالصخور ميدان أرضه والصلاة والسلام والتحية والإكرام على سيدنا الممجد بشيرنا المسدد نذيرنا المؤيد المصطفى الأمجد والمحمود الأحمد أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين المنتجبين الميامين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد وقوله الحق المبين، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: وعد الله المؤمنين والمؤمنات جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها ومساكن طيبة في جنات عدن ورضوان من الله أكبر ذلك الفوز العظيم. صدق الله العلي العظيم. My respected elders, my dearest youngsters, brothers and sisters in Iman, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Since this is presumably the last majlis whereby we'll be having all of us in the same hall, I think this would be an opportune moment to express my gratitude and appreciation, starting obviously, as was indicated in the Urdu Majlis, by offering our thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for granting all of us the tawfiq and the opportunity to engage in His remembrance and the remembrance of the pious personalities who gave everything for His sake. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to not deprive us of the reward that He has promised for the dhakirin. Insha'Allah, ameen. I would also like to extend my gratitude once again to all the officials and members of the Birmingham Jamaat for extending their invitation to us and facilitating all these programs. We are very grateful to them. And I'm really pleased to say that, mashallah, I have learned and gained a lot through the course of the interactions that I've had with the members of this community. I'm really grateful to all the volunteers who made this process possible. We have so many volunteers, I can't thank all of you, the car park volunteers, the webmasters, the audiovisual content creators and directors, the people who prepare the lecture summaries, I'm told. All of these people deserve our appreciation and our gratitude, and we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all of them. I would also pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all the youth of this community and our little ones for the interest that they showed. I want to thank the Abbasi Youth Committee for organizing the interactive workshop. I certainly was having the concerns that coming here in winter when it's so icy and cold, I was concerned that there might be some ice between us. But mashallah, your iman and your enthusiasm was really warm. And alhamdulillah, all the ice melted quickly and I was able to have some really good interactions with our youth. And I learned a lot from them and I learned a lot about them. The least of the things that I learned about them was, if I was ever in a train and I learned that one of them were the train drivers, I would jump out of the window. But alhamdulillah, I really was pleased to see that, mashallah, the level of interaction that we had, the QA sessions, alhamdulillah, I'm going back having gained a lot, and I'm really grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this opportunity. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all of you with the best of both these worlds. Ameen. That being said, we come to the topic of our discussion. Obviously, yesterday we had a very important workshop on parenting, And obviously, if I had not been stopped, that workshop would have probably gone until Salatul Fajr. We had so many questions and so many things we were dealing with. And I also had to keep in mind that in yesterday's majlis, I got a bit carried away and I exceeded the time limit by a total of 25 minutes. Which is unprecedented even for me. I don't know what happened to me. I got carried away. And I guess I'm tempted to place the blame on you guys because this only happens to me when I feel really at home. That's when I overstep my time limit. I mean, yes, brevity is not exactly my cup of tea, but generally I'm able to live up to the time limits that are set. But I guess yesterday, I guess I felt very much in home in your midst, and that's why I exceeded the time limit. Obviously, I apologize for that. And the excuse that I'll offer is, as I said, I have so much love for this community and for the members of this community interacting with you and all of that. I feel so at home that that is the reason that happens. And Quranically, it is established that when you truly love the people that you're addressing, this happens to you. In Surah Taha, Surah number 20, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about Prophet Musa alayhi salam. When he was in conversation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in verse number 17, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks him that, وَمَا تِلْكَ بِيَمِينِكَ يَا مُوسَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him a very simple question. Straightforward response. It was a one-word answer to this question. He asked him, وَمَا تِلْكَ بِيَمِينِكَ يَا مُوسَى. What is there in your right hand, O Musa? The simple answer, one word, was asai. He could have simply said, asai, my staff. That was what was in his right hand. But no, did Musa alayhi salam answer in one word? No, he answered with a long sentence. He said, قَالَ هِيَ عَصَايَ أَتَوَكَّأُ عَلَيْهَا وَأَهُشُّ بِهَا عَلَى غَنَمِي وَلِيَ فِيهَا مَآرِبُ أُخْرَى. He gave such a long response. And he added information that Allah had not even demanded. He said, Ya Allah, this is my asa. I lean on it. I use it for support. Allah is not asking him what you are using this asa for. Just what's in your right hand. But he volunteers additional information. He says, this is my asa. I recline on it. I use it for support. Wa ahushu biha ala ghanami. I use it to break the cause the leaves to fall down from the tree so that my sheep can eat them. And finally, when he ran out of uses, he said, waliya fiha ma'arib ukhra. And I have other uses also that I can mention. The ulama and scholars of tafsir, they are bewildered by this response. Why does he volunteer so much and why does he prolong the conversation? The ulama of balagha and rhetoric, Arabic tafsir, they come and respond to this question by saying that it is a well-established Quranic reality that the reason why Prophet Musa alayhi salam prolonged the response was because he was conversing with his beloved. When you talk to someone who is beloved to you, unconsciously, you desire to prolong the conversation so you get to talk to them more. And so that you can enjoy the benefit and the ladha of interacting with them for longer. So Prophet Musa alayhi salam, that's why he prolonged the conversation. He did not want to stop talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I guess I would say the same is the case here. But I know many of you from your faces, I could see some of the elders especially, they're like, huyu mtoto bana bala, kianza kuongea, he doesn't stop, he just goes on and on. So I do apologize for that, and I hope I won't repeat that today. But I want to come to the topic of our discussion, and obviously in the workshop yesterday, I received many questions. Obviously, we talked about approaches, right, to parenting. And I had presented before you a hadith of the Prophet in which the Prophet informs us that إِنَّ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى رَفِيقٌ يُحِبُّ الرِّفْقُ وَيُعْطِي عَلَى الرِّفْقِ مَا لَا يُعْطِي عَلَى الْعُنْفِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very soft. He's very lenient. He's very compassionate. He's very considerate. And he's soft, rafiq. يُحِبُّ الرِّفْقُ. Not only is Allah soft in terms of His dealing with His servants, He loves those of His servants who use soft approaches as opposed to more harsh and rude approaches. So then he goes on to say that وَيُعْطِي عَلَى الرِّفْقِ مَا لَا يُعْطِي عَلَى الْعُنْفِ. The kind of results Allah gives when soft approaches are used, He does not give those results when tough approaches are used. I received a lot of questions about this because some of the parents, obviously, they were like, you know, soft approaches in this climate and in this culture, will they really work? Will they really produce results? And yes, obviously, you have to understand every child is a different individual. I know that most of us, obviously, we study Western models of parenting and we come across those models where, obviously, you have that old-fashioned saying that, you know, you spare the rod and you spoil the child. So in Western scholarship and Western literature about parenting, you do see that they favor tough and, you know, stern approaches towards parenting. But what I would like to remind our dear parents is that if you want to base and organize your life around something, the best and most reliable thing to organize it around are the teachings of Ahlul Bayt, the literature of the Ahlul Bayt. We do not dismiss non-Muslim and Western literature. They are doing their researches and we praise them. And we should use them to supplant our own literature and to understand our own literature better. But the thing about non-Islamic sources of literature is you can't really base your life on it. You know why? Because to base your life, you need something solid. You need something that is impenetrable and unshakable. Western scholarship does not offer you that. Because when you rely on their researches are evolving and they're being updated every day. So there is no guarantee that what they're telling you today will even remotely resemble what they'll be telling you tomorrow. Their researches change all the time. Today they tell you one thing, tomorrow they tell you another thing. And I'm not saying that this is a bad thing. I'm not critiquing. This is actually good. This is how the sciences progress, through trial and error. But I'm just saying that if you are going to base your life on something, it better be solid. Because you don't want that you base your life on one idea and then tomorrow it's disproved and then you're like, okay, so what did I do? So basically, and this not only happens in, you know, in the social sciences, even in the exact sciences, the medical sciences or the physiological sciences, you have this. I mean, for example, in medicine, up to only a few years back, most medical doctors and professionals would tell you with 100% medical certainty that your appendix, that organ in your body, which is called the appendix, that it was a vestigial and superfluous organ and that it did not have any function or purpose. This is what they used to teach in classrooms all around the world, that the appendix is purposeless. It doesn't have any function. And obviously, they used to offer as evidence the fact that you can remove the appendix and a person can lead a healthy life. So their conclusion was, it doesn't have a purpose. A few years back, scientists at Duke University discovered that the appendix does have a purpose. Like I had mentioned, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, anything that is created, it cannot be purposeless. The fact that you don't know it or that you are ignorant of the purpose does not mean it is purposeless. They finally discovered the purpose. And they found out that the function of the appendix is that it harvests bacteria that help in digestion. It's not a very vital function, as is evidenced by the fact that when you remove the appendix, a person is still able to lead a normal and healthy life. But still, it is a purpose nonetheless. So yesterday, they were telling you with 100% medical certainty that your appendix meant nothing. It was simply a vestigial and superfluous organ. Today, they have changed that. They have updated their knowledge, and they're telling you, no, it does actually have a purpose. So this is the way science progresses. This is the way these human efforts, they progress. It happens to the best of them. That's how scientists work. Through trial and error, they're able to find out what works for them and what does not work for them. Even if you look at the history of many of the modern inventions of science, you find all the scientists who went through them, they went through the system of trial and error. For example, even if you look at a simple thing like the light bulb, if you look at the history of the invention of the light bulb, the one who invented it, Thomas Edison, do you know how many times he messed up, he screwed up before he could get a simple light bulb right? 2,000 times by his own admission. He used to admit that I got it wrong 2,000 times before I could get a single light bulb right. Obviously, you might ask, what kind of person messes up 2,000 times before they can get a simple gadget right? The answer is a scientist. That's how they work. Now, obviously, Thomas Edison had a very nice spin. He used to put a very nice spin on it, obviously, because people used to mock him. They're like, what kind of person you are? 2,000 times you messed up just to get a light bulb right? And he was like, well, the way I see it, it's not that I screwed up or I messed up 2,000 times. It's just that I found out 2,000 new and innovative ways how not to make a light bulb. But no matter what spin you put on it, you cannot disguise the fact that this is how human sciences progress. So really, if you want to base your life on something, you need something more solid than that. I'm not saying, again, that we should completely dismiss all those researches. No. Remember, Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. He used to address his followers and he used to remind them of a reality. He used to say that al-hikmatu dallatul mu'min, fakhudh al-hikmata walaw min ahli an-nifaq. Wisdom and knowledge, this is the lost property of a believer. Therefore, grab it wherever you find it. Even if you have to get it from a munafiq, take it. So you don't have to look at the sources, you have to look at what they're giving you. And after all, as we often say, even a wall clock that is not functioning, let's say the battery on the wall clock, it runs out of, and the battery is not working. Even a wall clock that is not functioning will tell you the correct time twice in 24 hours, right? Unless, of course, if it's a digital wall clock, then it won't tell you anything. But if it's an analog wall clock, even if it's not working twice in 24 hours, it will tell you the correct time. So in the same way, a lot of this scholarship that we have and all that literature that we have, there are a lot of useful and valuable things that we can glean from it, but we can't base our life on it. If you want to base your life around something, you need something as sure and as solid and as rock solid as what you get in the Holy Quran and the teachings of the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salatu wasalam. And what they prescribe for you, the model that they prescribe for you, is a model that is based on soft approaches. You start with soft approaches, and obviously if they don't work, yes, you have the authority, you are authorized to go for more stern approaches, but not until you have tried out and exhausted all the soft approaches. And remember, in showing love and softness and kindness to your children, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the only person who benefits is you yourself. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your children are an amana. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves children a lot. They are one of His favorite creations. That is why Prophet Musa alayhi salam, in a hadith Qudsi we are told, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, Ya Rabbi, ayyul ashya'i ahabbu indak? He said, Ya Allah, I want to know, in all your creations, who do you love the most? What is that thing that you love the most? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responded by saying, حُبُّ الْأَطْفَالِ فَإِنِّي خَلَقْتُهُمْ وَفَطَرْتُهُمْ عَلَىٰ فِطْرَتِي وَتَوْحِيدِي فَإِنْ أَمَتْتُهُمْ أَدْخَلْتُهُمْ جَنَّتِي بِرَحْمَتِي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the thing I love most about my creation are the children. Those are the objects of my creation that received greatest amounts of my love. Why do I love them the most? Because إِنِّي فَطَرْتُهُمْ عَلَىٰ فِطْرَتِي. Because they reflect the innocence with which the human being comes into this world. They reflect that uncorrupted mindset that yearns for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah says, فَطَرْتُهُمْ عَلَىٰ فِطْرَتِي. I have created them on my fitrah, and I have made them to believe in my tawheed. Naturally, children believe in tawheed, and that is why Allah says, فَإِنْ أَمَتْتُهُمْ. If I ever call back a child and cause them to die in their young age, أَدْخَلْتُهُمْ جَنَّتِي بِرَحْمَتِي. I immediately admit them into Jannah with my mercy, and I give them the opportunity to do shafa'ah for their parents. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really loves your children, and that is why, because He loves them so much, He rewards you when you show love to them. You don't realize this. In being soft with your children, you benefit. We have a beautiful hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. In which the Prophet of Allah just goes to demonstrate before you how the very small things that you do that you might not even notice, you don't even register them. You do them naturally and spontaneously, but Allah notices them, He records them, He registers them, and He pays you heavily for them. The Prophet of Allah says, مَنْ قَبَّلَ وَلَدَهُ كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَهُ حَسَنًا وَمَنْ فَرَّحَهُ فَرَّحَهُ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَمَنْ عَلَّمَهُ الْقُرْآنَ دُعِيَ بِالْأَبَوَيْنِ فَيُكْسَيَانِ حُلَّتَيْنِ يُضِيءُ مِنْ نُورِهِمَا وُجُوهُ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ. The Prophet of Allah says, every time a parent, a mother or a father, they kiss their child, you just simply kiss them, a peck on the cheek, you might think that's nothing, but in the eyes of Allah, the Prophet of Allah says, كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَهُ حَسَنًا. The moment you do that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala writes for you a hasana. He writes for you one good deed in the record of your deeds. Can you imagine? And then the Prophet goes on. He continues. He says, وَمَنْ فَرَّحَهُ فَرَّحَهُ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Whoever brings joy and happiness to the heart of their child, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring joy and happiness and gladness to their heart on the day of judgment. Can you imagine? It's a big reward that Allah makes you happy on the day of judgment if you make them happy in the life of this world. And then the Prophet of Allah goes on to say another thing, which brings me to another very critical point. He said, وَمَنْ عَلَّمَهُ الْقُرْآنَ دُعِيَ بِالْأَبَوَيْنِ فَيُكْسَيَانِ حُلَّتَيْنِ يُضِيءُ مِن نُورِهِمَا وُجُوهُ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ. As for those parents who work hard and they focus their energies on teaching their children Quran, introducing them to the Quran from a young age, cultivating interest for the Quran in the hearts of their children, those parents who work in this area, you know what reward Allah will give them? He says, دُعِيَ بِالْأَبَوَيْنِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for every child who excels at Quran or is connected to the Quran, Allah will invite, He will specially summon both parents. Both parents, the father and the mother, will be summoned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَيُكْسَيَانِ حُلَّتَيْنِ يُضِيءُ مِن نُورِهِمَا وُجُوهُ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ. And they will be made to wear garments of honor, robes of honor, which will be so bright, they will be so luminous, that because of the intensity of their brightness and their luminosity, when these parents will be made to enter Jannah, and obviously that's where Allah will send them. If they worked hard on their children, they will be sent to Jannah. When they will enter Jannah, the Prophet of Allah says, due to the intensity of the brightness and luminosity of their robes, the already illuminated faces of the inmates of Jannah will lighten up. The Ahlul Jannah, obviously their faces will be full of nur. But the nur that will be coming from the garments of such parents will be so strong that it will illuminate the already illuminated faces of the people of Jannah. Just goes to show you how much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards you if you devote efforts in this. And that's why the Holy Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, when addressing parents, he always used to say, and this is a hadith that we have, Amir al-Mu'mineen narrates it on the authority of the Prophet, he used to say, أَدِّبُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ عَلَىٰ ثَلَاثِ خِصَالِ حُبِّ نَبِيِّكُمْ وَحُبِّ أَهْلِ بَيْتِهِ وَعَلَىٰ تِلَاوَةِ الْقُرْآنِ فَإِنَّ حَمَلَةَ الْقُرْآنِ فِي ظِلِّ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ مَعَ أَنْبِيَائِهِ وَأَصْفِيَائِهِ. The Prophet of Allah used to say, make sure as parents, you cultivate three qualities in the hearts of your children right from a young age. Make sure you instill these three things. The first two are حُبُّ نَبِيِّكُمْ وَحُبِّ أَهْلِ بَيْتِهِ, the love of your Prophet and the love of the family of the Prophet. Instill it in their hearts right from a young age. And obviously the love of the Prophet and the love of the Ahlul Bayt should be the direct result of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You find oftentimes parents are lacking in this area. We find in so many places, alhamdulillah, in this community we have the madrasa and we have all these institutions. So mashallah, I've seen our kids are very aware. But in other parts of the world, we have seen, unfortunately, that many parents don't take time to introduce their children to their role models. Who the an'amta alayhim are and who the maghdubi alayhim are. You don't give them any information about that. And that's why I have seen in my own personal experience, I have surveyed. When I go to other communities, I have talked to the little boys and girls over there. And you find when you talk to them and you ask them, for example, a simple question like, who are your role models? Who do you aspire to be when you grow up? Who do you admire the most? You don't get to name, like when you interview these little girls, you'd expect to listen, for example, a name like Sayyida Zainab salamullahi alayha, or Sayyida Kulthum, or Bibi Sakina, or Bibi Fatima. You don't hear those names. Those little girls, when you ask them, who is your role model? Who do you aspire to be? Who do you admire? The answer that you get is you hear icons like Hannah Montana, for example. And it is not their fault. Obviously, parents have not taken the child to explain to them who their true role models are. But you see, this is disturbing because obviously when a girl like this, that's what she's watching all day long on TV. And obviously, the more you are exposed to something, the more you come to love it. You expose them to the literature and teachings of Ahlul Bayt, they will become passionate lovers of Ahlul Bayt. But if you expose them to other things, they will develop those. Those tastes will be cultivated. And then later on, it's going to result in problems. Because obviously, when a girl like this grows up and she says, Dad, I don't want to do hijab, don't be too surprised. Because obviously, Hannah Montana doesn't do hijab. So when her role model is like that, she will want to take after and imitate her role model. So that is why, حُبِّ نَبِيِّكُمْ وَحُبِّ أَهْلِ بَيْتِهِ, instill the love of Ahlul Bayt and the love of the Prophet right from the start. And introduce them to their true guides and their true role models. And then the third thing that the Prophet of Allah says is, وَعَلَىٰ تِلَاوَةِ الْقُرْآنِ, cultivate within them the habit of reciting the Qur'an. Connect them to this book. Allah has revealed it for their own benefit. Why? The Prophet says, فَإِنَّ حَمَلَةَ الْقُرْآنِ فِي ظِلِّ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ مَعَ أَنْبِيَائِهِ وَأَصْفِيَائِهِ. The Prophet of Allah says, because those who carry forward the message of the Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will place them in His special shade on the Day of Judgment, along with His Anbiya and His Asfiya. So really, as parents, if you invest yourself into this process, you invest efforts in this process, you will heap, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you with the greatest of rewards. And there will be a source, your children will be a source of great honor for you on the Day of Judgment. Because remember, when your children excel in this area, it's always the parents who benefit, apart from the children. You find Ma'ad bin Jabal has a hadith that he used to narrate on the authority of the Prophet, which has been narrated to us by Raja ibn Hayat. Raja ibn Hayat says, I went to meet Mu'adh bin Jabal, who was a very learned companion of the Prophet. I went to him with my father. When he saw me, I was a small boy at that time, he immediately turned to my father. And he said, هَلْ عَلَّمْتَهُ الْقُرْآنِ? He said, have you taught him the Qur'an? He said, no, I've not started because he's small. He turned to my father, Mu'adh bin Jabal, and he says, عَلِّمْهُ الْقُرْآنَ فَإِنِّي سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَقُولُ مَنْ عَلَّمَ وَلَدَهُ الْقُرْآنَ تُوِّجَ أَبَوَاهُ بِتَاجِ الْمُلْكِ وَالْكَرَامَةِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. That Mu'adh bin Jabal said to him, teach him Qur'an, start teaching him. He's not too young for that. Because I heard with my own ears the Prophet of Allah saying, those parents who teach their children Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will crown them with a crown of honor on the Day of Judgment. So all those fathers who are interested in being crowned on the Day of Judgment, and all those mothers who want to wear a tiara on the Day of Judgment, this is your way. Invest in your children and make sure that they are familiar with the Holy Quran, because that's the only way we'll have a society in which we can truly act as standard bearers of Islam. We need to promote Quranic awareness within our youth. Unfortunately, as I mentioned yesterday, there is so much this propaganda campaign that is going on against Islam. It is so extensive, and the people are working really hard. They're actually researching the Quran. They're researching the Hadith. They're researching the Seerah. And they're researching it with the aim of taking out stuff from there and then presenting it with an aim to vilifying and maligning the religion of Islam. The only way we can counter this is if we ourselves are Quranically aware. If we are well versed in the Book of Allah and the Hadith, that's the only way we can dispel the myths and the fallacies that they are trying to circulate and spread about the religion of Islam. Yesterday, we dealt with one of those issues. We talked about how they use certain verses from the Holy Quran to project the Quran as a book that promotes violence. And we saw how they are only able to do it because they quote things out of context. Remember, Islam is such a beautiful religion that the only way you can make it look bad is if you deliberately choose to be deceitful and you present only half the picture. That's the only way you can make a religion as beautiful as Islam look bad. And this is what they do. If you present only half the picture, you can prove anything about Islam. I can prove that Islam preaches atheism. If I take the kalima and I divide it into half, I just take one half and I say that it's la ilaha. See, Islam, the kalima of Islam starts by saying there is no God, la ilaha. Islam preaches atheism. Well, it's illallah after that. There is no God but the one true God. If you present, this is a very superficial example, but I'm telling you this is exactly what they do. In every argument that they bring against the religion of Islam, every criticism, it is based on this idea. And a lot of the times it is based on ignorance. There are some people who do it, who willfully misrepresent the fact. And then there are those other people who are truly and genuinely ignorant. With both these cases, we should engage. A lot of the times we find that when Islam is attacked or it is criticized, the response is emotional. The response is very sentimental. We all get hyped up. There's no need for that. Academically, as Amirul Mu'mineen explained, academically you simply explain to them where they've gone wrong. Because a lot of the times the reason why they form these wrong impressions about Islam is because of their ignorance. And once you understand that ignorance, you won't get that angry. Because you will feel pity at them. You will feel that they haven't understood it and you will try to explain it to them. Because when a person asks questions out of ignorance, you're not supposed to get angry at them. You're supposed to understand where they're coming from, okay? I often, whenever I look at criticisms that are leveled against the religion of Islam, I am reminded of an incident that I read about that really helps me in dealing with these kinds of things. It makes me understand where they're coming from. This incident, I read about it in an email that was forwarded to me by one of the brothers, I remember a few years back. The heading, the subject of the email was, why Bill Gates resigned as the CEO of Microsoft. Obviously, when I read that heading, I was like, really? He has resigned from Microsoft? I wanted to know the reason. So I opened the email, and obviously he hadn't resigned, but it was just a joke that they were saying that if he had read about this, he would have actually resigned. The incident that they narrate is about a Punjabi farmer, a poor Indian farmer from the state of Punjab. He was illiterate or semi-literate. He wrote a letter to Bill Gates, or at least he tried to write a letter to Bill Gates. This farmer was a beneficiary of one of the projects of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. You know, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, they're doing a lot of charity work in underdeveloping countries. They're trying to introduce technology in rural areas. So basically, this farmer, as part of this plan, he had received a desktop computer from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. So after receiving that computer and using it for a few months, he actually wrote a letter in which he tries to express his appreciation for what they have done for him. And he also tries to, you know, question some of the things that Microsoft had done. So if you look at the first part of the letter, it is full of appreciation. He starts by saying, you know, Sir Bill Gates, addressing him, he says, you know, sir, I am so grateful to you. I don't even know how to thank you. Your technology and these computers, they have revolutionized our life. They've made life so simple for us, and we're really benefiting from it. But there are a few questions and a few suggestions that I had for you. The first question that I have for you, and this is a very serious one, because I was very surprised to see it. He tells about how when the first day he received his computer, he says, when I opened it up and I looked at the keyboard, he says, I felt like something was out of place, but I couldn't place my finger on it. But I knew something was wrong. It didn't look right. So he says, when my child who goes to nursery school, when he came back, he took a look at the keyboard and he was like, Dad, there's something terribly wrong with this. So I turned to him and I said, Son, you know what? I also felt something. I can't place my finger on it. Can you tell me what is wrong? He said, Dad, the alphabets, I mean, it's supposed to be A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and this is Q, W, E, R, T, U. What is this? Who are these people who have designed this? Were they drunk when they were making the keyboard? They don't even know how to organize and arrange the alphabets? Duh. So he was like, what's the matter? Can you tell me? Can you explain to me how this happened? Because he says, I thought maybe this was a faulty product. So I traveled all the way to the nearest city. I went to the store and I asked them to replace my keyboard. And they brought out all the other keyboards and they all made the same mistake. I'm wondering what kind of people are you employing? Clearly the people you've employed to design the keyboard, they were absent the day the teacher taught the alphabet. So he says, please change that. It is confusing because our children, they learn the alphabet in the right order. English is not their native language. They have to go through so much effort to learn it the right way, and then your keyboard comes and it messes everything. Okay, that's his first objection. The second objection that he made was, he said, I really like about the fact that you constantly keep on upgrading all your technology, right? You started with Windows 98, or rather you started with MS-DOS, and then 98, 99, XP, Vistas, all of that. It's lovely. But there are some things that you simply refuse to upgrade. I don't know why. He said, for example, this Microsoft Word, I asked some people, they told me it's there since the beginning. When will you upgrade it to Microsoft Sentence? Because obviously after a word, you get a sentence. He says, if I was in your position, people would be using Microsoft Essay right now. The other thing he said was the recycle bin. He said, the recycle bin, you've been using it since 1998. We've been using this recycle bin. When are you going to upgrade? In a village, we start with a cycle, I understand, with a bicycle. They call it a cycle over there. When we get more money, we upgrade to a scooter. You know, when we get more money, we upgrade to a motorbike, to a motor car. He says, if I had the resources that you have, people will be using the re-helicopter bin. And you are still stuck at the recycle bin. At least give us the re-scooter bin. That was basically his idea. And the last one was truly a killer. He turned to him and said, you know, the last thing, I just had a question. And it's just out of my curiosity. So if you don't respond to it, I don't mind. But I just wanted to know, you know, maybe I could derive inspiration from this. He said, I noticed that your last name is Gates, right? Bill Gates. In India, you know, the family, in many places, the family name represents the family business. So this guy assumes that if he is Bill Gates, that would be his family business. So he says, if your name is Gates, I really wanted to know, how did you end up selling Windows? Because your product should have been named Gates, but you've named it Windows. I want to know the logical thought process that you went through, that you decided. It's a success story that, you know, you moved from, your family was selling Gates and you came to Windows. I want to know how you did that. So now they say that if Bill Gates had read this letter, he would have wanted to resign as CEO of Microsoft. But you can see what happened here. You laughed at this poor guy's questions. But the reality is, the only reason why he asked these kinds of questions is because he doesn't know the product. And so I'm sure if he came to you with these questions, you wouldn't receive him with hostility. You wouldn't be like, you know what, you're challenging the... No, you would receive him warmly and you would feel pity on him and you would try to explain to him that, you know, all these things that you've mentioned, for example, the QWERTY keypad. What this guy doesn't know is that the QWERTY keypad is actually, he was complaining in that letter. He said, you know, typing is so difficult because we are used to A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and this is Q, W, E, R, T, Y. What this poor guy doesn't know is that the people who made the keyboard, okay, first of all, it's not Bill Gates who made this keyboard, okay? This keyboard was used in the typewriter that was invented in 1890, so it's not Bill Gates who's responsible for that. And the reason why they came up with this configuration of alphabets, the reason why they arrange it in this manner, is because it facilitates for the fastest typing. They have done researches on this and they found out that the QWERTY keypad it enables you to type faster than any other configuration, and that's why they've given it to you. But obviously this poor farmer, he doesn't know the philosophy behind it. And that's why he thought that either the people who designed it didn't know what they were doing, they were drunk or they were ignorant, or that maybe they had made a mistake. The reality is when you look at most of the objections that they level against the religion of Islam, it's the exact same thing. It's ignorance. They don't know about Islam. And that's why a lot of the things that Islam has made to simplify life for us, they think it's designed to make life tough for us. All these objections that they make sometimes, they don't realize, like fasting, for example. You find many of the non-Muslims, they don't understand the philosophy. They say, you know, you starve yourself and you keep yourself hungry for all those long hours. God, you know, your God, He's supposed to be a very merciful God, then why is he putting you through this? What they don't understand is what Allah says in the Quran, that يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرِ. You don't understand the philosophy of this fast. If you fasted properly, this is going to make your life simple. It's going to make your battle against shaitan much easier for you to win. The only thing is you have to know the philosophy. So in every such case, we shouldn't lose our temper or become intolerant. Rather, whenever someone comes with a criticism against the religion of Islam, you should welcome them. They're giving you the opportunity to present a response. And obviously, like I said, you need to be equipped. You need to immerse yourself into the Quran and into the ahadith and literature of Ahlul Bayt so that you can dispel the myths or the falsehood that is being spread. I want to address one of the misconceptions because, like I said, number one, the area where they attack Islam is obviously the whole idea of jihad. And you know, the fact that, you know, there are certain circumstances in which Islam allows the use of force. I think we dealt with that. And all those objections they raise about, you know, the battles of the Prophet. They say if he was a Prophet of mercy, why did he take part in so many battles and, you know, engage the Kuffar and the Mushrikeen in all those wars? What is the philosophy behind that? You can all explain it to them very easily. I remember, you can give them examples, for example. I remember when I was in grade 3, we learned about, I think it was grade two actually, we learned about the UN peacekeeping forces, okay? And I was really small at that time. So when I first heard of the term and the concept that the United Nations have a body that they refer to as the UN peacekeeping forces, the image that I conjured in my mind was the peacekeeping forces would be an army of men and women who would be dressed in white. They would be carrying white flags and olive branches, and they would be sent into conflict regions to create peace. But when I saw the photos, when my teacher showed me the photos of the UN peacekeeping forces, they were like a regular army with tanks and machine guns and all of that. So I remember I turned to my teacher and I said, these are UN peacekeeping forces. What are they doing with guns and tanks? They're supposed to be peacemakers. And that's when my teacher explained to me. She said, Sweepy, the thing is that in the life of this world, there are some people who do not understand the language of peace. So you have to use force. Sometimes if you are truly interested in establishing peace on this earth, you have to be willing to use moderate force. In the same way in Islam, all the battles of the Prophet, they were fought in defense of human rights. They were fought in defense of the innocent lives of people who are living in Medina. So you need to present all of that and make it clear to them that Islam, if it allows the use of force in certain circumstances, it's only because the aim is to establish peace. As Allah says in those verses, I said they always quote verse 191. Look at the verses after that. Allah is again and again emphasizing the same thing, that وَقَاتِلُوهُمْ حَتَّى لَا تَكُونَ فِتْنَةٌ وَيَكُونَ الدِّينُ Lillah, that fight them only as long as you can ensure that there is no persecution in the land, that everyone is free to practice their religion, that Islam is freely available to everyone. So basically, these are things that you need to explain to them. Another of the areas where they love to attack Islam, and after terrorism and violence and all of that, this is the number two favorite area that they always like to dwell on, and that is the treatment of women in Islam. And obviously, this is a very vast topic. We need a series of lectures to address the issues and the allegations that they raise against the religion of Islam in this area. But obviously, I realize I have very little time. So I'll just give you glimpses of some of the areas that we need to address. Many times, for example, the whole question of equality. The argument is that in Islam, women have not been given fair treatment. Islam discriminates against women. You hear that a lot. You hear that all the time. In fact, after terrorism, that's the number two argument. And that's why I often say that if I had, for this one, this argument against women, that Islam does not give them equality, if I had a dollar or a pound for every time they made this argument, I wouldn't be richer than Bill Gates maybe, but at least Richard Branson and Lord Sugar, I think I would be richer than them combined, because they use it a lot, and they use it on, you know, talk shows and all that. You need to be equipped and you need to be prepared. You need to understand. When they come forward with this argument of inequality, what are the arguments they use? For example, they use a verse from the Quran. The first verse of Surah An-Nisa, Surah number 4, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَيْكُمْ رَقِيبًا. In this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O human beings, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your Lord, who created you from a single soul, and from it He created its partner. They take this verse of the Quran and a certain hadith that has come to be associated with it, and they try to give the impression that in Islam, women are considered to be inferior. There is a certain hadith that has been attributed to the Prophet, whereby in explanation to this verse, the Prophet is reported to have said, and obviously this hadith is there in Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, in the sources of the Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, this is what is taught. That the Prophet is reported to have said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He says that He created from it its partner, the meaning is that Allah created Bibi Hawa, He created woman from the ribs of Prophet Adam alayhi salam. And obviously you can see the connotations of this are very negative. Because when you say that the woman has been created from the ribs of the man, ribs are curved in shape, right? That means woman is crooked by her nature. That's how she is. So obviously, and they take this hadith and they superimpose it on this verse of the Quran, and they say, see, Islam, fundamentally it's teaching you that women are unequal, that they have been created from the ribs of men, and that is why they are on a subsidiary position. How do we respond? Well, like I said, what is the lesson you learned from that 12-year-old boy? Return to the sources, the original, authentic sources. When we come to the Imams of the Ahlul Bayt, alayhimus salatu wasalam, we find that a man once came to Al-Imam Abu Ja'far Muhammad Al-Baqir, salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi. And he put this question before him. He said, Yabna Rasulillah, min ayyi shay'in khalaqallahu Hawa. He said, Yabna Rasulillah, can you tell us from what Allah created Bibi Hawa? The imam turned to him before responding to the question. He said, "Mada yaqulun nas?" He said, "First tell me, what do people say? What do you hear the people and their scholars saying?" He said, "Yaquluna inna Allaha khalaqaha min dhil'in min adla'i Adam." They say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created woman from the ribs of the man. When the imam heard this, he said, "Kadhabu. Akan Allahu yu'jizuhu an yakhluqaha min ghayri dhil'i Adam?" He said, "There are liars who spread this information. Those who say that Allah created a woman from the ribs of man, they're liars. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not create woman from that." And then the imam posed a question. He said, "Akan Allahu yu'jizuhu an yakhluqaha min ghayri dhil'i Adam?" He said, "What are you trying to say? Those people who suggest that Allah created woman from the ribs of man, what are you trying to suggest? Are you trying to suggest or imply that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, na'udhu billah, was running short of building materials when he was creating woman, that he didn't have anything, so he had to pull out a rib from Adam and he created woman from that?" He said, "No." So then he said, "Famin ayyi shay'in khalaqaha ya ibn Rasulillah?" So then from what did Allah create? The imam said, "Simple, visit the Quran. What does Allah tell you in the Quran?" He says, "Walaqad khalaqna al-insana min sulalatin min teen." We created insan. Insan refers to both man and woman. We created both man and woman from clay. So then the imam explains. He says, "Inna Allah ta'ala qabada qabdatan min yameenihi wa kilta yadayhi yameen. فَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا آدَمْ وَفَضَلَتْ فُضْلَةٌ فَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا حَوَّى." The imam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he created Adam alayhi salam, what did he create him from? What does he tell you in the Quran? From a mixture of mud and clay. He says, "Well, after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Bibi Hawa from the same mixture of mud and clay. The man and woman both were created from the same substance. Then the question is, where did this idea come from? It came from Judeo-Christian sources, because you find in the early history, when people turned away from the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, many of the scholars, they began to rely on Judeo-Christian sources. And you find this idea is there in the Bible. That's the place where it originated from, and that's how it got into Islamic literature, when Muslim scholars started relying excessively on Judeo-Christian sources. And that's why you have this whole category of Israeliyat. That is the Israeli riwayat that have been taken from Judeo-Christian sources. In the Bible, in the book of Genesis, chapter number 2, verse number 21, when God talks about the creation of Adam and Eve, especially the creation of Eve, this is what is mentioned. Because it mentions there that God wanted to create, because Adam was feeling lonely, so God decided he would create a partner for him. So what did he do? The first thing he did was, in verse number 21, we are told, he caused Adam to fall asleep. Must have given him some kind of anesthesia or whatever, but he caused him to sleep. After that, he pulled out a rib from Adam, and from that, he filled it with flesh, and that's how Eve was created. So that is a Judeo-Christian conception. How did it come into Islam? Because obviously they started relying on those sources. But when the matter was brought before the Imams of the Ahlul Bayt, alayhi salam, the original authoritative sources, they cleared the misconception and they said there is nothing, no such thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created both man and woman from the same substance, which means what? That fundamentally you are equal. There is no point of comparison. If Allah had created you from different substances, you could argue that we as men are superior, or men are inferior, women are inferior. But you cannot make that argument. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sealed the deal. He created you from the same substance. And therefore, there can be no point of comparison. There can be no superiority or inferiority. And that's why really, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, when it comes to talking about the essential status of men and women, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala establishes that they are both absolutely equal. And this is the truly unique thing of the Quran. The fact that it always includes women in the discourse. This is something that even non-Muslim scholars of the Quran, they have acknowledged and they have appreciated the Quran for it. I was listening to a TED talk by Leslie Hazelton, who is an agnostic Jew. She was admitting and acknowledging in her TED talk that the Quran, when it comes to gender egalitarianism, it is amazing. She says it's truly remarkable that a book that was revealed in that period could be so gender inclusive. She says, and these are her words, not mine, she says the Quran is very different from the Bible. The Bible, when it addresses, obviously you read the Bible in English, so you don't realize it. But if you read it in the original Hebrew and Greek, you will realize that the Bible is not even addressed to women. It does not include women in the discourse. The reason being, men in those days, they were not sure, and they used to have debates about this issue. They were not even sure whether the woman had a soul. There were debates about this. Does a woman have a soul, or is she a soulless entity? It took them centuries to figure that out. And that is why you find when the men who were writing the Bible, when they wrote the Bible, they excluded women from it. It was written for men, because obviously the Bible, the aim is to teach you about spirituality and religion. And the perception was, because they don't have a soul, they probably, religion is not their cup of tea. Spirituality is not meant for them. And so that's why in the Bible, Leslie Hazelton says that women are excluded. But in the Quran, she says it's amazing to see every verse that is addressed to the believers, it includes women. And that is why she went on to give examples. that absolutely go to show how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has established equality between you. And that in terms of spirituality and opportunities to please Allah and elevate your status, you all have the exact same opportunities. So the most remarkable and the most striking verse that she found in the Quran with regard to this is verse number 35 of surah number 33. Although we can give many other examples, but this is the most definitive verse that you can offer to show how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has leveled the playing field and He has offered equal opportunities to both men and women to please Him and to seek high stations. So in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and He goes out of the way to include women into the discourse. He says, إِنَّ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُسْلِمَاتِ وَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَالْقَانِتِينَ وَالْقَانِتَاتِ وَالصَّادِقِينَ وَالصَّادِقَاتِ وَالصَّابِرِينَ وَالصَّابِرَاتِ وَالْخَاشِعِينَ وَالْخَاشِعَاتِ وَالْمُتَصَدِّقِينَ وَالْمُتَصَدِّقَاتِ وَالصَّائِمِينَ وَالصَّائِمَاتِ وَالْحَافِظِينَ فُرُوجَهُمْ وَالْحَافِظَاتِ وَالذَّاكِرِينَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا وَالذَّاكِرَاتِ أَعَدَّ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةً وَأَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. It's a beautiful verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts men and women together. He says, verily, the Muslim men and the Muslim women, the believing men and the believing women, the humble men and the humble women, the truthful men and the truthful women, the patient men and the patient women, the men who spend of their wealth in charity, the women who spend of their wealth in charity, the men who fast for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the women who fast for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the men who guard their modesty, the women who guard their chastity, the men who remember Allah excessively, and the women who remember Allah excessively, for all of them, أَعَدَّ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةً وَأَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. At the end of it, Allah has prepared for them the same reward, which is what? His maghfirah, His forgiveness, and ajran azima, and a great and abundant and handsome and magnificent reward. So now notice, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse did not have to make the verse so long. He could have easily used the masculine plural, and it could have included women as well, because in Arabic, the laws of Arabic grammar state that the masculine plural, because Arabic is a very rich language, the masculine plural encompasses the female plural. So if Allah had only said, إِنَّ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْقَانِتِينَ وَالْخَاشِعِينَ وَالصَّابِرِينَ وَالصَّادِقِينَ, if He had only used the masculine plural, it would include the women. Unless otherwise specified, it naturally includes women. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala went out of the way to mention them separately to show you, to shatter the misconception that people had that women are not expected to have a spiritual relationship with Allah, or that the rewards that Allah has prepared are only for men, the way men had been promoting in the previous centuries. To dismantle this belief, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala went out of the way to place men and women on the same par and to put them on the same level as each other. Just goes to show you the Quran's commitment to gender egalitarianism and gender equality. So really, if you look at it from this perspective, and if you look at it from the perspective of the teachings of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, there is no scope and there is no way you can argue. If you understand the teachings of the Quran, like I said, all the objections and all the criticisms are based either on ignorance or they are based on willful misrepresentation of the facts. Otherwise, if you look at the evidence very clearly shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them the same status. Spiritually, they are same. Yes, in terms of their rights and their responsibilities, and because biologically they are different, obviously the rules and regulations and the responsibilities are different. And it is these differences that these people exploit to try and make it look like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not given them enough importance. I realize we don't have time. Otherwise, we would have liked to address the issues, like, you know, all the issues, inheritance or testimony or the fact that Islam allows or it kept the door to the institution of polygamy open. All these criticisms, if you analyze them closely enough, you will come to realize that Islam has given women, it has actually elevated women. And it has freed them from the slavery that they were suffering from. And even today, Islam offers freedom to all the women who are suffering from the slavery of that is dictated upon them by the modern materialist culture of this world. Obviously, time does not allow. I would just like to conclude by pointing out that as far as all these issues is concerned, what we need from our brothers and our sisters is to come forward. Obviously, as I said, there are so many feminists, there are so many so-called women's rights activists who are campaigning against Islam, and they're trying to portray Islam as a male chauvinist religion, as a male-dominated religion that does not attach enough importance to women. We need our sisters to speak out, to come forward and speak out. It doesn't always look good that when Islam is attacked on its treatment of women, that men should come forward and say that, you know what, no, Islam has given them a fair deal. We need our sisters to follow the example of Sayyida Zainab and step up and speak out to these feminists who claim to be speaking in your name. Because many of these feminists, they come and they say, you know, they say we feel so much concern about, you know, our Muslim sisters, they're suffering so much oppression and, you know, they're not given their freedoms and their rights in Islam. As Muslim sisters, it is your duty and responsibility to study your religion. And when you study it, you will find Allah has given you the kind of powers and privileges He has given you. You won't find them in any other system. And that's why you need to come forward and respond to these feminists and say that, you know what, if you think you're showing us all that pity and sympathy and you're saying that you understand that we are undergoing so many problems and this, you don't know what you're talking about. If you think we need your sympathy or your pity, you are barking up the wrong tree. The kind of honors and privileges that Allah has bestowed upon us, you will not find them in any system. And really, it is true. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the level of attention that He has given to women in this religion, I'll just share with you one tradition that just goes to show you. Yes, there is no doubt there are certain areas where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given men the edge because they have more responsibilities. But definitely Allah has compensated for that by giving women the edge in certain areas. And He has balanced the whole equation through that. You find this is a hadith that Imam Ali ibn Musa Ridha salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi. He used to narrate it on the authority of his forefathers, all the way up to Amirul Mu'mineen, who narrates this authority on this hadith on the authority of the Prophet. That the Prophet of Allah said, this is one area, this is one hadith that you can offer to show them that if you think that Allah is discriminating against women, think again. In this hadith, what are we told? It's narrated in Usulul Kafi, that the Prophet of Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى عَلَى الْإِنَاثِ أَرْأَفُ مِنْهُ عَلَى الذُّكُورِ وَمَا مِنْ رَجُلٍ يُدْخِلُ فَرْحَةً عَلَى امْرَأَةٍ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَهَا حُرْمَةٌ إِلَّا فَرَّحَهُ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. The Prophet of Allah says that there is no doubt when it comes to His servants, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very merciful. He is very considerate, He's very compassionate, He's very forgiving. But in terms of His servants, He gives some of His servants a greater share of His mercy. And He is prepared to show more consideration and more mercy and forgiveness and leniency in the case of some of His servants than other servants. And that's why in this hadith He gives you the principle. He says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى عَلَى الْإِنَاثِ أَرْأَفُ مِنْهُ عَلَى الذُّكُورِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more inclined to show love and mercy and forgiveness and kindness to His female servants than He is to His male servants. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obviously His mercy is for everyone. Men and women, both of them receive abundant shares of the mercy of Allah. But comparatively, the Prophet of Allah is saying that Allah has reserved more of His mercy and leniency and forgiveness for His female servants than He has for His male servants. And obviously as men, you cannot complain. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them this to honor them for their sacrifices and their contributions, which you don't make. I mean, obviously, the things that they go through, just to bring us into the life of this world. You think that journey of pregnancy, it's easy? To bring us into the life of this world, all those 9 months, the things that they go through, only Allah knows. Morning sickness, it's only morning sickness, but it's a misleading term. It can happen any time of the day. And you have so many other things. It's a roller coaster ride, emotionally and hormonally. But they go through all of that. And then after we come into the life of this world, they go through so much trouble to raise us and to take care of every need. Obviously, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honors them for that. And obviously, remember, not only do they take care of us, who takes care of the men? There are many women out there who say that often you can have as many babies as you want in a house, but the biggest baby usually is the husband. He is the crankiest and he's the most fussy. You know, I don't want this, I don't like that, why is this, why is that? So the toughest baby to deal with in the house is sometimes the husband himself. These days, modern husbands, can be a handful. So obviously they go through all of this, they give so many sacrifices. Because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honors them. And the way Allah honors them, I don't have time. Otherwise, the hadith, they will boggle your mind. We have a hadith in which we are told that the Prophet of Allah addressing the women, he said, because you know, even women in those times, sometimes they used to feel like, you know, what opportunities do we have? Well, the Prophet of Allah addressing mothers, he says that, أَمَا تَرْضَى إِحْدَاكُنَّ أَنَّهَا إِذَا كَانَتْ حَامِلًا مِنْ زَوْجِهَا وَهُوَ عَنْهَا رَاضٍ أَنَّ لَهَا مِثْلُ أَجْرِ الصَّائِمِ الْقَائِمِ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. The Prophet of Allah addressing the women and the mothers, he says, does it not please you to know how enviable you are? Does it not please you to know that when one of you becomes pregnant with a baby and her husband is pleased with her, she gets the thawab from the moment of conception to the moment of delivery. Every single moment, she gets the thawab of a person who fasts during the day and stays awake all night for salah. Imagine, if we were to do that for 9 months, or if we were to do that for the whole year, the thawab that we would get, fasting during the day and staying up for prayers all night, every second of your pregnancy, Allah gives you that thawab. And then the Prophet of Allah says, it doesn't stop there. فَإِذَا وَضَعَتْ لَمْ يَخْرُجْ مِنْ ثَدْيِهَا جُرْعَةٌ وَلَمْ يَمُصَّ مِنْ ثَدْيِهَا مَصَّةً إِلَّا كَانَ لَهَا بِكُلِّ جُرْعَةٍ وَبِكُلِّ مَصَّةٍ حَسَنًا. The Prophet of Allah says, after you deliver your baby, then obviously the stage comes whereby you have to nourish the baby. The Prophet of Allah says, when you breastfeed your baby, for every drop of milk that goes into the mouth of your baby, for every drop Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala writes for you a hasana. He writes for you a good deed. And then the Prophet continues. He says, فَإِنْ أَسْهَرَهَا لَيْلَةً كَانَ لَهَا أَجْرُ مَنْ أَعْتَقَ سَبْعِينَ رَقَبَةً فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. And he says, if your baby disturbs you or keeps you awake at night, because there are two kinds of babies, you know. There are some babies who are very sharif. They're well-disciplined. They do as nature intended. They are awake during the day and they sleep at night. But unfortunately, this is a minority, a very microscopic minority of babies. Majority of babies, oh my God. I don't need to go very far to give examples. I was one of those cranky babies. My mother says, you know the kind of baby you were? You would make Hitler look like a used car salesman. That's how loud you were. So basically, there are some babies who really, they during the day, they are awake. They are like so fresh and active. And at night, okay, if you're fresh and active, be my guest. But at night, at least let the parents sleep. No. They will sleep during the day, and they will wake up at night, and boy, they won't let you sleep. And that's why the Prophet of Allah says, "Fa in asharaha laylatan." And you know, it's painful to be woken up from your sleep. You can imagine how mothers deal with it. So the Prophet of Allah assures the mothers. He says, "Don't worry about it. Fa in asharaha laylatan." If your baby ever wakes you up at night, kana laha ajru man a'taqa sab'ina raqabatan fi sabilillah. The moment your baby wakes you up, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you the reward of freeing 70 slaves for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't have the time, otherwise I've given you the riwayat that talk about the reward of freeing one slave for the sake of Allah. The thawab is mind-boggling. Here Allah gives you the thawab of freeing 70 slaves. I often used to wonder, why does the mother only get the thawab? Because when the baby cries, the father wakes up. So I asked my mother, and she was like, "Beta, you don't understand. You'll understand it when you grow up. Men, they have inbuilt earplugs. So the baby can cry his heart out and he won't be bothered." It's the mother, bichari, who has to wake up. But you see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appreciates you and how He rewards you? And that's why Allah has so much honor for women in His sight. In this hadith that I mentioned on the authority of Imam al-Ridha, what does the Prophet conclude? He says, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more loving, He is more forgiving, He is more kind, He is more considerate when it comes to His female servants, comparatively, obviously, for men also Allah has reserved a lot of forgiveness, but comparatively they get more because their contributions and their sacrifices are greater. Because of that, the Prophet says, for men, you can also benefit from this. How? The Prophet of Allah says, مَا مِنْ رَجُلٍ يُدْخِلُ فَرْحَةً عَلَى امْرَأَةٍ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَهَا حُرْمَةٌ إِلَّا فَرَّحَهُ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. No man brings joy or happiness to the heart of any female member of his family, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, between whom there is hurma, like they're your mahram, right? If you bring joy or comfort or happiness to the heart of any female member of your family, whether it's your wife, your sister, your mother, fuima, masi, auntie, dadima, whoever, any female member of your family, you bring happiness to their hearts, فَرَّحَهُ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Allah promises you the same thing that He promised you for children. He will bring happiness and joy to your heart on the Day of Judgment. There is so much more literature that we can share on this area. This is, like I said, a series of lectures is required. And obviously, I know Prophet, I don't want to, you know, exactly take Prophet Musa's sunnah to the ultimate extreme. So obviously I realize, but this is a message to our sisters. Read up this literature. It's available. Study it and then present it to those non-Muslims out there who come forward and make the claim that Islam discriminates against women. It doesn't appreciate them. It denigrates them. How? They haven't read the literature. They're ignorant. For example, in the case of the station and position of the wife, oh my God, in their societies, they have this conception that like the Muslim wife is an oppressed entity. She doesn't have any rights. She has to, you know, go by the diktats of the husband. She's oppressed. She's suppressed. She doesn't have any freedom. All of that is nonsense. They haven't read the literature. Look at the traditions of the Ahlul Bayt. You get the true Islam over there. I'll just share with you one narration that goes to show you how Islam elevates the position of the Muslim wife. We are told when Amir al-Mu'mineen and Bibi Fatima were going to get married, the Prophet of Allah summoned Amir al-Mu'mineen. And he gave him a list of instructions that apply even to this day. One of those things that the Prophet told Imam Ali was what? He said, Ya Ali, إذا أدخلت العروس بيتك فخلع خفها واغسل رجليها. The Prophet of Allah made Imam Ali do that. He said, Oh Ali, when your wife is brought before you on the first night, take off her slippers and wash her feet. Can you imagine? This is what Islam does to the status of a woman who has realized her station. That Imam Ali alayhi salam, who is Sayyidul Awsiya, he is the chief of all of the successors of the prophets of God, you find he washed the feet of Fatima al-Zahra. And he washed it, and after that the Prophet said, once you're done washing, what do you do with the water? You don't just go and throw it away. No. What do you do it? That water has blessings in it. He says, صُبَّ الْمَاءَ مِنْ بَابِ دَارِكَ إِلَىٰ أَقْصَى دَارِكَ فَإِنَّكَ إِنْ فَعَلْتَ ذَلِكَ أَدْخَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ بَيْتِكَ 70,000 لَوْنٍ مِنَ الْغِنَىٰ وَأَخْرَجَ عَنْ بَيْتِكَ 70,000 لَوْنٍ مِنَ الْفَاقْرِ. The Prophet of Allah said, sprinkle that water around your house. If you do that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow 70,000 different kinds of rahmah and barakah to enter your house. And he will remove poverty from your house. And this became a sunnah for all of the followers of school of Ahlul Bayt to follow. And that is why it is a tradition. I don't know if you observe it here. But on the first night, it is sunnah of the Ahlul Bayt that you are made to wash the feet of your wife. Why? To show you the station that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that these servants, my female servants, are so precious in my sight that I will bless the feet with which you have washed their water to show you how important they are and so that you should respect their rights and honor them. So really, all those people who make these arguments that Islam has not given them a fair deal, that they haven't read the literature. It is our duty as followers of the school of Ahlul Bayt to present that literature to them so that they can be more aware of it and they shouldn't make those arguments. Obviously, there is so much more that can be said about this. I obviously have to conclude by bringing you to the battlefield of Karbala, where obviously you see the real tragedy that the religion of Islam and the Prophet who taught the world how to honor women, the manner in which they treated the women of Rasulullah, the fact that they paraded them all the way from Kufa to Sham, and in Sham, the manner in which they treated them, as you are informed in the riwayat, for 8 hours they were made to stand outside in the burning sun. And the fact that they were put in chains. You don't realize it, but there were so many of the children of the Ahlul Bayt, the little children, who would drop from their camels, who would fall down, and they would die. They would be crushed and trampled upon by the camels. They went through so much. The request that I received for tonight was to share some of the masaib of Bibi Sakina as well. And so that is why, obviously, in two of the majalis we did that. But as I mentioned, the masaib of Bibi Sakina, they don't come to an end. This daughter of Imam al-Hussein, the level of love that she had for her father, you already saw what a difficult time it was for Imam al-Hussein to bid farewell to her. I just want to present to you two scenes that just go to show you how much love Bibi Sakina had in her heart for her father and for everyone else in her family. The riwayah used to be mentioned by Allama Murtada Mutahhari. He used to say that in the thick of the battle, when Imam al-Hussein fell from his horse, he got separated from his horse. And that is why as soon as the dust cleared, the horse of Imam al-Hussein was one of the horses of Rasulullah. He immediately began to search for his master. And that is why the army of Umar ibn Sa'd, they tried to block its path. They didn't want to let it reach Imam Hussein. But the horse began to charge towards them. So Umar ibn Sa'd ordered them. He said, Da'u. He said, leave him. Let him go to his master. So they left him. Imam al-Baqir narrates, when the horse came, what did he do? He says, أَقْبَلَ يُمَرِّغُ نَاصِيَتَهُ بِدَمِهِ. The horse began to rub its forehead in the blood of Imam al-Hussein. And it began to kiss and to smell the body of Imam al-Hussein. It began to rub its face at the body of Imam al-Hussein. It realized that its master had left this world. Imam Abu Ja'far al-Baqir narrates, he says, you know what that horse was saying in its own language? كَانَ يَقُولَ الظَّلِيمَةَ الظَّلِيمَةَ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ قَتَلَتْ إِبْنَ بِنْتِ نَبِيهَا. The horse was crying and it was crying out that, oh, what oppression, oh, what oppression the ummah of this prophet has shown to the grandson of its prophet. And that is why after that, we are told, the horse begins to return. You know, in those days, horses used to be trained. They would, once their master and their rider would be killed, they would come and notify the family members. In a certain way, they would come and stand that the family members would know that the master has died. This horse, it begins to return towards the khiyam. As soon as the women notice that the horse has come back riderless, they all come out from the tents. One BB comes forward, she begins to pat the horse. Another BB comes, he catches the leg of the horse. Another BB comes, he kisses the horse. All the BBs, they surround the horse. They say at that moment, the Rawi says in the Maqtal, at that moment the curtain of the tent was lifted and a very little girl, only 3 years old, she comes out from the tent. As soon as the horse notices this girl, he leaves all the BBs and he rushes towards that little girl. The horse remembered this girl. This was the same girl who was preventing him from taking her father to the battlefield. So he feels it's his duty to inform her of the death of her father. And that is why the horse quickly rushes to Bibi Sakina. He comes and he stands in front of Bibi Sakina. He lowers his head and Bibi Sakina gets the message. She turns to the horse. Do you have the heart to listen to the statement that she made? She turns to her horse and she says, Ya Jawada Abi, Hal Suqiya Abi Am Qutila Atshana. She says, Oh the horse of my father, oh the loyal horse of my father, I know that my father has been killed, but just answer one question of mine. I am dying to know that did they give my father water before they killed him, or did they kill him thirsty? This little daughter had so much concern for her father that she's asking the horse, did they give my father water? The horse lowered its head and it indicated that the water was not given to the imam. And that is why we are told, look at the concern and love of Bibi Sakina. We are told on the night of Shami Ghariba, when the wife of Al-Hur, and these are just the last masaib, when the wife of Al-Hur, she brought some water and she brought it to the tents of Imam al-Hussein. She came to Bibi Zainab and she said, this is some water for you. As soon as Bibi Zainab got the water, she remembered who was the loudest in saying al-Atash, al-Atash. So she immediately goes to Bibi Sakina. Bibi Sakina had fallen asleep. She goes to Bibi Sakina and she wakes her up. She says, Sakina, wake up, the water has come. As soon as Bibi Sakina hears the name water, she immediately gets up and she says, Oh, my aunt, has Uncle Abbas returned? Because water in her mind was associated with the memory of Abbas. This was the uncle who was martyred getting water from me. So she says, Oh my aunt, did Abbas come back? Did our uncle come back? Bibi Zainab says, No, this is water. It has come for you. You may drink water now. Bibi Sakina looks at the water and she gives it back to Bibi Zainab. She says, No, I don't want to drink this water. You drink it. Bibi Zainab says, No, I cannot drink it. You have to drink it. She says, Why do I have to drink it? Bibi Zainab explains to her. She says, Because in our culture, in the culture of Ahlul Bayt, whenever something comes, we give precedence to the youngest ones, to the smallest ones. We put them first. We give them water first. As soon as Bibi Sakina hears this, she grabs the pitcher. She grabs the water from the arms of Bibi Zainab and she rushes towards the maqtal. Bibi Zainab follows her behind. She says, Sakina, where are you going? She says that you said in the culture of the Ahlul Bayt, we give water to the smallest. Isn't Aliun al-Asghar the smallest? I saw how thirsty his throat was when the enemy pierced it with his spear. And that is why I want to go and give this water to Asghar, because he died more thirsty than I was. And that is why Bibi Sakina had such a difficult time. She had to deal with him until the very end. We are told in the Zindan of Sham, they were in prison, they were without a roof. Bibi Sakina in the evening, she would look at the birds and she would ask Bibi Zainab, she would say, Oh my aunt, where are these birds going? Bibi Zainab would say, they are all going back to their home. Bibi Sakina would say, Oh my auntie, when will we go back to our home? I am tired of this place, I am tired of this loneliness, I am tired of being separated from my father. And that is why, in the last moments of her life, her only dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was to join her in the company of her father. And that's why when the caravan returned to Medina, you will listen to the details in Arba'een, but one just small detail. When Bibi Fatima Sughra came looking for the caravan, the Bibi that she was looking for after Aliun al-Asghar was Bibi Sakina. She asked Bibi Zainab, where is the amana of my father? And Bibi Zainab turned to her and she said, the amana of your father is sleeping in Sham. She could not survive the ordeal and she gave her life for the sake of Allah in Sham. Ala la'natullahi ala al-qawmi al-zalimeen. Wa sa'alamu al-lazina al-zalamu ayyamun qalabiyan qalibun.